Ave Maria.
Brethren, be strengthened in the Lord and in the might of his power. Put on the armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and the powers, against the world rulers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness on high. Therefore, take up the armor of God, that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and stand in all things perfect. Stand, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of justice, and having your feet shod with the readiness of the gospel of peace, in all things taking up the shield of faith, with which you may be able to quench all the fiery darts of the most wicked one, and take unto you the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, that is the word of God. St. Paul gives us advice on how we are to manage our affairs in this world. And first and foremost, he insists throughout that we should keep our eyes fixed firmly in heaven, where Christ is. But even as we travel through this valley of tears, we are besieged by enemies. And so he tells us that we have to arm ourselves. But what kind of enemies except spiritual ones? And therefore, the way in which we arm ourselves must be spiritual. So when we consider a soldier in engaging the war, first of all, he has a training. And he is then armed, and he is told how to use his arms. And similarly, in the spiritual warfare, we receive a training, and then we're told how to use the arms we have received. But that is not sufficient. We also need to know the enemy whom we are fighting, whether the enemy is far away or close at hand, whether the enemy is strong or weak, whether the enemy is stupid or cunning, because those are important factors. If we presume the enemy is weak, and he proves, in fact, and he turns out to be strong, then we are certainly in serious trouble. And so we also need to know whom we are fighting. And then we also need to know the terrain in which we fight. So whether we're going to be fighting uphill or downhill, whether we're going to be fighting on sand or on solid ground, or whether we're in marsh or water, whatever. So all of these things need to be taken into consideration spiritually as well. And this is what the apostle goes on to do. So in regard to the enemy, he tells us who the enemy is, that he is the wiles, he's cunning, the wiles of the devil. This is what we must guard against. And since the devil is cunning, and far more cunning than we ourselves could possibly imagine, we cannot hope to outdo him in cunning, and therefore we have, as the apostle says, to put on the strength of God, be strengthened in the Lord and in the might of his power. But then he goes on to describe the enemy. He says, we're not fighting flesh and blood, that is, human agents, but rather we are fighting principalities and powers. And so, again, that tells us something about the enemy. When he says we're not fighting flesh and blood, it is true that we do fight, we do have enemies, human enemies. That is certainly true. But St. Paul is pointing out that even these are driven not by their own malice so much as the malice of the devil. Or to put it another way, a pen writes. But we do not say it's a pen writing, but rather the one who uses the pen. And that is in fact how we ought to regard our human enemies. They are simply being moved by a wicked power, a malicious entity. And that way, we do not attack the pen, but rather we go to the one who uses the pen. And he continues to tell us the kind of enemy that he is. Principalities and powers. This describes two of the ranks of the angels. there are 9 choirs of angels. And although angels from all choirs, all the ranks, fell with Lucifer, he points out 2 in particular. The first rank, the first 3 choirs, are directly concerned with the divine majesty, the seraphim, cherubim, thrones. And so they are all ministering to God. So angels who fell from that rank would not be classed here, because don't forget, we engage in a warfare. And then in the lower rank, the virtues, the archangels and angels are concerned with the things of God in regard to us. And so we don't attribute the, St. Paul doesn't attribute these either as a danger to us, except in the sense that he would say an angel of Satan was sent. But the other two are very important, the principalities and powers. Because the principalities are those who lead. They're the princes, they go ahead. In fact, it says in the Psalm of David that the princes joined the choirs and led them to the temple. And this, in fact, is the work of the princes to lead. And so the demonic powers we're facing are those who lead the attack against us. And then the powers are those who have the ability to punish those who are below them. So then we are dealing with ranks of angels. In fact, St. Paul calls them rulers of this present darkness, who are not only active and engage in a serious warfare against us, but also have power to punish or to destroy. And we see that in the case of possession. So he says, this is what, in fact, we are facing. And he tells us now how we are, in fact, to defend ourselves against such formidable enemies. He says, therefore, take up the armor of God. Take up the spiritual armor that has been given to you. Why? Because without the armor of God, we will not be able to do what? To resist the evil day. So without God's protection, we cannot hope to overcome the evil that afflicts us each day and every day, and in particular, the last day. So first is we'll be able to resist in the evil day, and secondly, to stand in all things perfect. And so he starts off with this most important skill of every soldier. The first thing that a soldier is taught is to stand. Stand, therefore. When we consider wrestlers or boxers or sportsmen in general, the first thing that they taught is to stand. Soldiers, how to stand, so that if they are struck, they will not fall. Because once a soldier has fallen, he is in even greater danger of losing his life. So even if one is struck, one does not fall. And so he starts off with this very thing, and he tells us how we are to stand. Stand in all things perfect. So that means that we must have this, the virtues, the cardinal virtues, the moral virtues, justice, prudence, temperance, fortitude, as well as the theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity. Because these are the virtues that perfect us, that make us truly human, and even more than that, make us angelic, as our Lord himself says. So then, we have to stand in the virtues. In other words, we need to cultivate the virtues and not to be moved away from them. So then, he begins by telling us the first of them. Stand, therefore, having girded your loins with truth. Now, the loins, essentially the waist. Our Lord speaks also of the loins where he says, be as servants, having your loins girded and your lamps burning. So the loins girded is essentially the virtue of temperance. We must be able to control our passions. And of course, in the case of the lamp, that is faith. But when our loins are girded, then indeed we have our passions under control. So our energies are not dissipated but rather we are perfect and able to focus on the task at hand, namely to resist the evil one. But how do we gird it? We're told with truth. So it's here we see the importance of truth. Our passions must be controlled, must be tied down with truth. Because it is, if we go back to the garden, and going back to the garden is always important for us to understand the kind of warfare that we are in. It was because our first parents did not gird themselves, their loins, with truth, that they believed the lie of the serpent. They had rejected the truth God had said, you will die. Secondly, they allowed their passions to get the better of them, inasmuch as they saw that the fruit was good to eat and it was desirable. And so all of these passions, the desire for that which is forbidden, arose. And so they were undone and we with them. So truth is important. And the truth, of course, is a person. And so we gird ourselves with Christ Jesus himself. Our Lord speaks on many occasions about the truth, saying that it will make us free, for instance. And this freedom is nothing other than the freedom of the children of God, inasmuch as once we know the truth, we're able to discern where evil is and where danger lies. So if we know where we're going, we can get there easily. If we don't know, if we don't have the truth, then we will most certainly get lost. In fact, we may not even arrive where we wish to go because we do not know the way, which is what Thomas asked, said to the Lord, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And he goes on to tell us the importance of truth. So girding our loins, our passions with truth, then we are fairly safe. And we notice in the world in which we live that truth plays a very little part in it. In fact, we are surrounded by deceit. We no longer are certain of that what we're hearing, even over the news and the most respected of broadcasts, we have no certainty that what we're hearing is the truth. And if we pay close attention, we will see that what is broadcast is continually changing. But truth cannot change, because truth itself is eternal. And then he goes on to say even more, and having put on the breastplate of justice. Well, the breastplate is to cover the chest, and within the chest cavity are all the vital organs. And so this must be protected. But how do we, in the case of a soldier, it's done with some metal or something to resist any attack. But spiritually, he tells us how we are to guard our hearts, namely with justice. And justice is essentially to give to each what is due to them. So it means essentially we avoid covetousness or the desire to possess things and to build a place for us, for ourselves here and now. And it also to keep our eyes fixed on our destination. And this he continues by saying, having your feet shod with the readiness of the gospel of peace. So our feet also must be covered, because indeed if our foot is injured, then we cannot be able to stand. And on the contrary, we are as good as defeated. So the feet also must be shod with the gospel of peace, and in all things take up the shield of faith. So he's telling us how we are to dress. Now, again, if we go back to the Old Testament, we can already see how important this is, but applying it in our experiences today. Where in the Old Testament do we find the people being instructed to do exactly this? Have your loins girded, have the sandals on your feet, carry a staff, and to eat quickly when they were leaving Egypt. This is how they were to eat the Passover, girded and shod with a staff ready to move. And When the order was given to leave, the whole people left. We're told that not a dog barked after them. And more, they were able to carry the gold and the silver of the Egyptians. Because the Egyptians were so afraid, they said, go quickly. And the Israelites said, give us your gold and silver, which they did. Now, this was, in a sense, an injustice. And they would pay for it. Because in the wilderness, what would they do with the gold and silver but to build the golden calf? So we learn from this that we have to be careful even about the good things of this world, making sure it doesn't become a snare for us in the future. And so they went out and going to the promised land. And when they actually arrived, after all that they suffered, when they arrived at the promised land, they refused to go in. Why? Because they had already become so attached to the things of the desert, they were afraid. They said, if we go in, we will have to fight. God had been with them all the time, and yet they were afraid to fight. And so when we look at our own situation, we have received so many gifts that the Israelites received in shadow, in type. We have received the reality. So even as they went through the Red Sea and were baptized in Moses, we also were baptized. Even as they received the manna, we also received something greater than manna, Jesus Christ himself. Even as they were led by the column of fire, we also are led by the Holy Spirit who came down on Pentecost and who is with us, as our Lord says, until he comes again. And he's the Spirit of truth who will lead us to the whole truth. And so, even as they had to face all of the various temptations in the wilderness, so we also must face these temptations spiritually and not be discouraged by them, but keeping our eyes fixed on heaven, knowing that we will have to fight our way in heaven. Our Lord himself tells us that. He says that the gates of heaven are taken by violence. And the violence that is undertaken, again, is against our own self, that we need to discipline ourselves in order to inherit eternal life. So the battle is on, the battle is serious, and it is intense. It's so easy to become distracted and to ignore it. But nonetheless, we have to constantly reflect on what the sacred scriptures tell us and to do what Christ our Lord has told us. That is to hold fast to the truth. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis.